Welcome, everybody. Let's begin with any announcements that we might have for the life of the church or the community. Anything that we should know about. We've been so busy, maybe we're actually taking a little breath and resting. So, no, I don't see any particular announcements right now. Okay. Actually, I do have one. And that is that the church will be hosting a celebration of life for Rocky Stone on Tuesday, July 16th from 6 to 8 o'clock. It is open to anyone who wants to come and share stories and just remember Rocky, who passed away this winter, that her family just organized this event in the last few weeks. So that's the only one I have for you right now. Anything else on your mind? Alright, then please, just turn to your neighbors. Make sure that everybody around you feels welcome. If you are new to us, introduce yourselves. And if you are not new to us, say hello. Please pass the peace.
Thank you.
turn into your bulletin, you'll find the call to worship there. This is based on Psalm 30. Listening God, we come to give thanks for your listening presence with us. Liberated God, we come to give thanks for the ways you transform difficult times with your merciful grace into times of celebration of God's abiding presence. Trustworthy God, we come with hope and faith to you and bring to you our fears that tie us up in knots, so that we become isolated and alone with all of our worries.
Understanding God, we know we can present ourselves with our real and imagined problems, but even then, as you are able to freely be with us
and our This is the time in the service. Can you read out?
Yes.
When you may share out loud any joys or concerns that you have, you will also create a moment of silence for any things that you can't say out loud. Sue, I see your hand is raised.
Yes, first the moment of joy to celebrate the wedding anniversary of our dear Reverend Gail and Chris. Oh, happy wedding anniversary.
We've been at it.
And secondly, prayers of concern for our friend Seal, who has a medical issue that she needs to contend with. So please pray for Seal.
Prayers for our friend Seal, who is undergoing treatment for a specific condition, and it's a new diagnosis and it's quite serious. So prayers for her healing.
Thank you.
Other prayers, celebration, or concern for the life of this church and community. Let us add Richard Augustine and Jean Melchizara to our ongoing prayer. They are both recovering from strokes. Richard Augustine is in a step-down unit now, down in the Cape. He has a very long journey ahead of him. He is making good progress, but it is a very frustrating process for him. Jean has recuperated quite wonderfully today in her recovery from stroke. We have other families that are also facing new and ongoing diagnoses, cancer, diabetes, Parkinson's, various dementia or Alzheimer's, different conditions that are challenging people and sometimes are life-limiting. And so always we pray with those who need healing or stability or comfort or dignity, and especially for those who are helping to take care of the ones that we love, because where does the love of God become a living expression if it is not in the hands and the feet of those who tend to our most vulnerable people? Any other expressions of concern or celebration? Well, yes, Kevin.
Today is my mother's birthday. She passed away April last year. That's a beautiful day for her birthday.
All right, so in celebration for birthdays of those that are still among us and those that have gone ahead of us, and especially with gratitude for Kevin's mother and the beautiful day that brings her to mind today, and for other people's anniversaries as well, their birthdays and anniversaries. Prayers of solidarity for people living in and around the earthquake areas and the effects it's had on our lives. Did I see another hand? And not that we're going to be biased, but you know, prayers for success for the women in the World Cup. I didn't say which team. We often try to also include things that bring us joy. And so If you have any wildlife sightings or any flora and fauna that have given you great joy recently, we love to hear about those kind of things. This morning at 8 o'clock, one person was saying there's been a yearling bear visiting quite regularly at her home and was nose-to-nose with her cat just the other day. And there have been some beautiful deer showing up and then gobbling people's gardens. So there's sort of the next blessing there, too. A lot of bird songs follows, blue jays, crows, ravens, and mountain laurel.
We have a brand new fawn in our neighborhood. It's a little late, but the doe finally gave birth to her.
So a late-born fawn who's hanging out in the neighborhood, yeah? So the first flower blooms in your front yard and it's red. Did I catch that? So joy for the blossoms that are flourishing around us. Lori Kinsey mentioned the mountain laurel down at Tin Mountain in Albany. Yes?
I went to a new campsite and there's a farm there and there was a baby pig that was near death. And I prayed about it, and he's getting better. Of course, the medicine's probably helping too, but I'm so worried about the baby pig, you know. And the ponies, you know, I've seen them, and they come up to me, and it's just been nice to be on a farm at a camp and seeing all types of birds and butterflies.
So the birds, the butterflies, oh man, there have been so many butterflies, right? They're just gorgeous. And the ponies and a baby pig that's actually doing okay.
Yeah.
Fair and messy.
Yeah.
Any other sightings? Pardon?
This isn't exciting. It's just something that happens to us in June, and it is our backyard is a sea of babies, the whole thing. Yesterday, the fungus mold went on, and a deluge. They were swaying, moving, and it was amazing to watch.
A sea of wildflowers, daisies, swaying in the thunderstorm. Hey, gratitude for the thunderstorm that dropped the humidity and dropped the temperature by 25 degrees.
And then the beautiful
lightning. Beautiful sunset. Beautiful sunset outside. Anything else that you want to share? We share these things to remind ourselves about where we live. And because when we come here and we share things that cause heartache, we also need reasons to balance that out with some joy, and sometimes it's the world around us that gives us that reminder and that perspective. Please pray with me. O Holy One, Creator, Christ, and Comforter, the One who brought us into this world and placed this world in our keeping, we are called to love what we see, what gives us joy, what helps to balance out the heartache at the root of some of our prayers. And we are called to see love and divinity in each other, in the faces of every person that we come into contact with. Those who are in this room, those who are out camping, those who are on our streets, people that we may never meet. May we see each person in this world as a child of God. We ask for your presence for those that we have named out loud today and those that we have not named, that whom we hold in our hearts, those who are grieving, those who are enduring treatment for different kinds of challenging diseases, those who love them, those who help to take care of them, those who feel disconnected or are working towards some kind of recovery, people celebrating birthdays and anniversaries of all kinds. We offer you now our silence. And we've prayed together now, as you first taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Just as a side note, I found this candle this morning sitting on the table with the cross. Somebody had come in and lit it and said their own prayers and left us the candle. We have three readings this morning. The first will be read by Bob.
First reading is from Galatians 6, verses 1 through 10. My friends, if anyone is detected in a transgression, you who have received the Spirit should restore such a one in the spirit of gentleness. Take care that you yourselves are not tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. For if those who are nothing think they are something, they deceive themselves. All must test their own work. Then that work, rather than their neighbor's work, will become a cause for pride. For all must carry their own loads. Those who are taught the word must share in all good things with their teacher. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for you reap whatever you sow. If you sow to your own flesh, you will reap corruption from the flesh. But if you sow to the Spirit, you will reap eternal life from the Spirit. So let us not grow weary in doing things that is right. For we will reap at harvest time if we do not give up. So then, whenever we have an opportunity, let us work for the good of all, and especially for those of the family of faith.
From Luke chapters 1 to 10. After this, the Lord appointed 70 others and sent them on ahead of him in pairs to every town and place where he himself intended to go. He said to them, The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Go on your way. See, I am sending you out like lambs in the middle of wolves. Carry no purse, no bag, no sandals, and greet no one on the road. Whatever house you enter, first say, Peace to this house. And if anyone is there who shares in peace, your peace will rest on that person. But if not, it will return to you.
And then today, I was in the bathroom looking at the window, and there was this beautiful yellow butterfly fluttering desperately to get out. And I, remembering this, which I will read to you in a minute, I grabbed a face block and I grabbed her and I let her free. And she just flew off, and I said, What? And I went back into the bathroom, and I looked again, and I could see this dark, brown, small, insignificant butterfly. And in my heart, I said, I didn't pay any attention to you. And I realized because she wasn't big and beautiful and fluttering, she was just there. So I said, I need to rescue her tomb. So I picked up the same napkin and I rescued her tomb. It was really an interesting experience, and it will follow as I read this. Call me by my true names. Call me by my true names, because even today I still arrive. Look deeply. I arrive in every second. To be a bud on a spring branch, to be a tiny bird with wings still fragile, learning to sing in my new nest, to be a caterpillar in the heart of a flower, to be a jewel hidden itself in a stone. I still arrive in order to laugh and to cry, in order to fear and to hope. The rhythm of my heart is the birth and the death of all that are alive. I am the mayfly metamorphosizing on the surface of the river. I am the bird which spring comes, arrives in time to eat the mayfly. I am the frog swimming happily in the clear pond, and I am also the grass snake who, approaching in silence, feeds itself on the frog. I am the child in Uganda, all skin and bones. My legs are thin as bamboo sticks, and I am the armed merchant selling deadly weapons to Uganda. My joy is like spring, so warm it makes flowers bloom in all walks of life. My pain is like a river of tears, so full it fills with four oceans. Please call me by my true names, so I can hear all my cries and laughs at once, so I can see that my joy and pain are one. Please call me by my true name, so I can wake up, and so the door of my heart can be left open, the door of compassion.
Please pray with me. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, our Rock and our Redeemer. Amen. So you heard three different readings just now. You heard a message from Christ sending out his followers ahead of him to go out to all the different towns that he anticipated visiting. And his instruction was to go into the home and offer peace there, to offer healing, to offer whatever kind of services would be of use to the people in that community. And then, perhaps 20 or 30 years later, we have this letter from Paul writing to a community, and he's helping them think about how to live in community. They are a young community. They are forming themselves around a new movement. And they're not actually doing very well at living in community just yet. And so the entire letter is an instruction on how to sit down and eat together, how to put aside your ego, how to share each other's burdens, how to see in each other the children of God, brothers and sisters, and to realize that people need different things and that we are called to offer those different things. And then we had this final reading by Lori, which is a poem by Thich Nhat Hanh, which he offered originally when he was about to address the UN and had just heard about some bad news. And he wrote this in response to the bad news. I didn't give you all of the verses, I gave you some of the verses, but he's reflecting on the reciprocal relationships that exist in the world, our interdependence one with another. That those who are most vulnerable are in connection with those who have authority and power. That we are always in relationship, and sometimes those relationships are out of balance, and sometimes they're in balance. And in its way, this is the same message that Christ is talking about when he sends people out in pairs, not alone, but in pairs, into communities. And that Paul is discussing when he asks people to bear each other's burdens. When we think about what's happening in the world, when we think about things, as we said during our prayers, that are daunting, that are hard, when we try to do what we did last week, which was name the things in the valley that we hope need to be transformed in order to create a more equitable landscape for more people, housing, economic justice and a living wage, education for all people that's equal, so many different things that need to be addressed, addiction, peace in the home so that people aren't afraid of domestic violence. Those things are overwhelming. And the solution is never that one person's going to fix one of them or all of them by themselves. Even the followers of Christ were sent out in pairs. And so when we feel overwhelmed by the idea of carrying each other's burdens, part of what we're hearing is that to be in community means that we share the load. We don't do it alone. This morning, people were talking about concern for the conditions at the border, specifically the children. And people were thinking about, I wish I could get on a plane and go down there and do something about what's happening at the border. And then we talked about how if you got on a plane by yourself or a bus by yourself or you drove somewhere where you think something bad is happening, how much of an impact by yourself can you make? When you feel geographically separated and powerless in the face of an issue. And yet, the next thing that we talked about was that New Hampshire's own Stafford County Jail receives all the detainees in New England who are seeking asylum or refuge. We mentioned this a couple of years ago in church, that to even receive somebody, to become a host community for somebody who is seeking asylum, requires not just one person to offer their home, but at least a dozen families to take up the different parts of responsibility for supporting an individual in a vulnerable position. That's one example of how many people it takes to support one person. The way station, which we're running down Nativity Lutheran, it's been open a couple of weeks, and we've helped about 12 people so far. All of them have been referred in by other agencies, and they come for different reasons. But it takes multiple volunteers just to get the space ready. It takes several churches just to get us up and running with the starting facility and program to begin to address the challenges for families that find themselves displaced, for individuals who are looking for a regular shelter and meanwhile are living in different places, or for people that do have a roof over their heads but have to make a choice between paying for laundry and buying some more groceries for their children or putting gas in their car. There are so many churches helping to keep the way station up and running. So many volunteers who are taking the training just to be able to work a shift, and other people that are doing other things in the background. To help one person stabilize takes many, many people, many agencies, many faith communities, a whole collaboration, a whole partnership and network of support. It takes a valley full of people that see the importance of a single soul to help to stabilize them. We are called to bear each other's burdens, but we are not called to do it alone. We are called to do it in partnership. And we also realize that you can't pick up every single burden that's out there. When you think about it, there's usually something that you are passionate about. Maybe it's animal rights. Maybe it's specific human justice issues. Sometimes you're called to put your time and your energy in one or two places because you can make a greater difference by by focusing on those few causes, knowing that there are other people that are passionate about other causes. And doesn't it take a whole community to focus on the many causes that are out there? When we come here together, we take a breath. We renew ourselves, not by ourselves, but together. We think about what is important to us. We think about why we do what we do. And then we find people that have a like mind, a like passion. And together, we make that difference. We become the team that is sent out in front of love into other communities or into our own community, into places that we never looked before. And we see it in a new and a different way. This week, people that had felt invisible made themselves known to me because Pride Week happened a week ago. People that had felt unwelcome suddenly started to feel that they have a place here, that perhaps they can stay here in a new and a different way. To be seen is a gift. To be loved is a gift. But to love other people usually requires more than one person. We can't do it by ourselves. None of us can. This is the reminder that we are given today to bear each other's burdens, but to do it together and to find joy in each other. We're not all work, we're play. And we need to love each other with joy and with playfulness. You live in me. I live in you. Call me by my true name. Call me by the name of the ones that I love, the ones that I touch, the ones that I connect with. If you see me, who else do you see in me? Who have I spent my time and my life with? Who have my hands touched? Who have your hands touched? When I see you, how many other lives am I seeing through the lens of your hands and your eyes and your feet? With whom have you interacted? For whom have you been the love of God going ahead and lifting up a person and seeing a person in a new way? And when I see you, what stories do you have to tell me, and who do you help me see in a new and different way? Each of us is more than just one name, more than just one community. We are a gathering of souls. We are shaped by the people we love, by the people we help, by the people that help us and change us and teach us. Call me by my true name, that the door of my heart might be open to compassion, and that the lifting of the burden will not be so heavy, because I am doing it with you in community. Thanks be to God. Please rise if you're able for the song, Lord, I Want to Be a Christian. Page 403. Apparently we almost ran out of fours for the board today because we had so many songs before them. Please be seated. As we mentioned last week, this church, like many of the churches in the valley, has become a safe place where people can come when there are gaps in the services or the help that sustains them. But we are also a place sending out our support and our love to other parts of the world, such as Zimbabwe. Please be generous in the ways that you are able to be generous. Turn to the insert in your bulletin, you will see the service for communion. We begin with the Sursum Corda in Sanctus. God be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to God Most High. It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto you, everlasting God. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you, and singing together. Doesn't matter. nothing we can do can deserve the love and the grace that is offered to us, nor can anything that we do turn it away from us. We come together, beloved for whom we are right now, and we are all welcome to this expression of love. And in the same breath, that love that came into the world for us because we turned away again and again comes to remind us that there is nothing that we can do that will make that love leave us behind. That love meets us where we are and offers all that we need and loves us with every fiber of being and every breath and every heartbeat for who we are and forgives what is broken and binds us together again. Thanks be to God. If the deacons would please come forward. Story after story is the story of Christ breaking bread, and where there was not enough, praying over those elements as we do this morning and calling God to be present and asking, take what we have, take what is here and make it enough and more than enough for what is needed in the world. Feed your children first with the body and then feed them, feed us, heart and mind and soul. Thanks be to God. Friends, this morning you are invited to take of the bread that is enough. Again and again, Christ prayed over the bread, and then he put it into the hands of those who followed him, and he asked them to carry it to those who needed it. Even the act of offering the bread was done in community and communion. Friends, this is the bread of life, the bread of hope, the bread of life. It is offered for you. Take me and do so in reference. In the same way, Christ's first miracle was to turn water into wine. That has flowed through the world flows out to you today. Amen. Water itself is life. Without it, we cannot exist. And without the love that animates us and sees us, we are dust. This is the cup of life, the cup of blessing, the cup of renewal. Be transformed. Drink and remember. Please join me for the Thanksgiving. We are not alone. God made us. Can anything separate us from the love of Christ? No. In all these things, we win an overwhelming victory through the one whose love for us has been proven. Neither death nor life, neither messenger of heaven or ruler of earth, neither what happens today nor what may happen tomorrow, neither power from on high nor power from the low, nor anything else has the power to separate us from the love of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. And this is the part where you get to stand and just stay standing. Please rise for the song 404, Love Divine, A Love's Expelling. And then we will roll into the benediction, which is printed in your bulletin. If you are able, you are more than welcome to come into the parish house afterwards and join us for a more of a social kind of sharing of refreshments. And if not, I'll see you at the front door and you get to ring the bell. must have been burned on that side. Please, Prince, go in peace, and go calling each other by your true names, and seeing all the lives that you have touched and held, and all those who have touched and held you. Carry all those names within your own, and go in peace. Amen.